Okay, hi, my name is Leo. I'm from Tripliner. My presentation won't be so technical. It's more company focused. It's more of how I started up Tripliner and how we utilized PHP as our backend framework. Yeah, so let me do a quick run through of the agenda. First, I'll do a quick introduction of myself, and followed by that, I'll talk more about what Tripliner is and what Tripliner does. And followed by that, I'll talk about a technology stack that we have adopted for Tripliner, and I'll answer the questions why we use PHP for our backend framework. And after that, I'll open the floor to some Q&A, and you can ask any questions you like. So quick introduction, I'm Leo, so I'm the co-founder of Tripliner. I graduated from NTU 3-4 years ago, a degree of computer engineering. I specialize in IT infrastructure and database technology. I previously worked in HP as a technical consultant delivering high available cluster IT infrastructure for big MNC companies such as like Singtel, Schneider and what's not. Yeah, that was before I quit my day job and pursue my passion and start Tripliner as a travel company. So move on to what Tripliner is. So Tripliner is actually an itinerary planning platform for travelers to plan their itinerary as well as organize their travel in a single place. I'm pretty sure all of you all have been on at least one holiday. And the toughest part about planning your trip is not about booking your flight or your hotels. There's a lot of platforms out there that help you do that. But it's actually finding places that you want to go and be able to organize the places that you want to go in a single platform. So I met with this problem when I actually graduated and I went for my graduation trip in Europe for 21 days. So surprisingly, I took 6 months on and off to plan my whole itinerary. Yeah, I'm the anal kind of traveler. 2 p.m. I'm going to do this, 4 p.m. I'm going to do that. So so it really took me 6 months to plan my whole itinerary from start to finish. So I was thinking, why did it take so long? So I went onto the web, I tried to Google, itinerary planner or what's not. And itinerary planners I found out there was very complex. They had a big map, you could search for places. The learning curve was either too steep or it just required too much effort for me to learn how to use it. I'd rather just go back to, I think most everybody use it, Google Docs, Excel spreadsheet, Google Maps. You plot your stuff, where you need to go, bring it with you, print it out or what's not, and you got your itinerary, right? So, as an engineer, I decided if such a platform don't exist, what can I do? As an engineer, build it yourself, right? So that's how Tripliner was born. So the unique thing about Tripliner is the way you actually discover for places for your holiday. So on Tripliner, you discover places through photos. These photos are actually geotagged to places that we have in our database, and these photos are actually called travelogues. Photos speaks 1,000 words. So as you browse through these photos that people have been there, done that, taken a photo, and actually posted it, you can actually get a sense of which are the places you should be going to, and pick those places to actually go to when you for your particular destination or what's not. And it's so simple to be able to decide on a place and then quickly add this place to bucket list it into your itinerary just by a simple click. And what we have done is take it one step further to be able to not just only bucket list your places, but be able to create a timeline to be able to have an itinerary of 2 p.m. I'm supposed to do that, 4 p.m. I'm supposed to do that, so it's perfect for me. To be able to create that timeline and take it with you offline without internet connection and be able to use that itinerary when you go for your holiday. So that is something that a lot of planners out there sort of can do, but do it in a very complex manner. So what we focus on in Tripliner is actually to make the process as seamless as possible to the user. And just last week, we launched something pretty cool. It's called Hotel Bucket Listing. And what we have done with Hotel Bucket Listing is actually analyze the way that travelers plan, book their hotels. Right, so the whole process of booking a hotel, you usually go to your OTA, go in a couple hundred hotels, narrow it down to 3 or 4 hotels that you might want to book. But statistics have proven that usually travelers do not book on the first session. They usually book on the third or fourth session, right? So what we have done with TripLiner is allow you to incorporate the bucket listing of hotels that you can put into your itinerary, and then keep referring back to them, keep checking the prices. And when you're finally ready to book, or you get a 10% discount on hotels.com, you can go in, proceed on and check your price, actually follow up with your booking. So what we have done with TripLiner is actually create not just a planning tool, but organizing tool for travelers to plan the itinerary and organize it in a single platform. So next, I'll talk more about our stack, our technology stack that we use, that we have adopted for TripLiner. So on the underlying layer, we run on EC2 instances on Ubuntu. And the reason why we use EC2 instances is because of scalability. It's very easy to scale. As and when we have the demand, we can simply spin up instances to, you know, just be able to absorb the load that we are having. And for the database, we are using MySQL and as well as Solr Apache for text search indexing. For the web server, we are using Apache to serve out dynamic and static content, and PHP MVC framework as our backend. For our front-end web application, we are using HTML5, CSS3, jQuery, and jQuery Mobile. This stack is a pretty standard LAMP stack. You see quite a bit, and it's very easy to implement. You can actually just one command line, and everything is up, kind of thing. Yep. So why PHP? First reason, it's very easy to learn, right? To be honest, I never knew how to code in PHP. I only learned Java when I was in school. And I learned a lot of HP, UX, Linux stuff, but I never learned how to code in PHP. So when I had to choose a framework for TripLiner, I Googled one thing into the Google search. What's the easiest framework to learn? Right? And surprisingly, PHP came up. Right? So what I did, I committed myself 2 weeks of my time, went to YouTube, type in PHP tutorial or what's not, and just purely just learn PHP to bring my whole application up. And I managed to do it in 2 weeks to have a backbone, a skeleton and everything. So it was that easy to learn. And next, the community. As PHP is a very mature language, the community is vast, it's big, it's huge. Any questions or any kind of problems that I have, more or less, when you Google it, Stack Overflow has it. If not, you know, documentation is very well documented, and being able to have that actually improve the whole, decreases the time to actually, you know, come up with a working product. And lastly is organization, right? With PHP MVC framework, if you follow it correctly, it's actually very organized. You know, be able to see your projects and your project files in a very nice manner. As a startup, you usually iterate very fast. When there's a problem or there's a bug fix, it doesn't take weeks or months to solve. It should take 2-3 hours at the max, right? So with this organization, being able to know where every single file is, being to know literally where every, more or less every API, RESTful API call is and what's not, it's very useful so that you don't need to, you know, go and search for it even before even solving it, right? And we do use PHP as our backend framework for RESTful API interfaces. So for versioning, it's really, really simple. To build that framework and to be able to duplicate different versions, you know, upgrade so that we can support our legacy versions as well. And yeah, that's really what PHP was. That's what we utilize PHP for, and it's very powerful in terms of that, being able to organize all that together and be able to move forward without taking a step back to, you know, to have some new features being rolled out or what's not. Yeah, so my presentation is very quick. I would prefer if you guys ask me questions, anything, whether it's PHP related or, you know, startup related or what's not, then, you know, from there I can, you know, try to answer your questions. Yeah. Yeah, great. When I started out PHP, I the most common ones was MVC framework, right? So I didn't know much about PHP, so I just Googled it and I just went to YouTube, and this person actually built it from scratch. So I just followed his tutorial and built it from scratch. So I did not use your like a Zen framework or what's the other one? PHP Cake Ignite or something. So I didn't use any of those frameworks. So I built it from scratch. And the reason I did that was not because it's easier to use a framework, but I also wanted to learn, you know, from ground up to be able to learn how to program in PHP, because I didn't know how to do that. Luckily, it was a bit more object-oriented, so it's a bit similar to Java, so there was a plus point, so I learned it pretty fast. So I wanted to learn the language at the same time as building the product itself. So I think that process actually brought me a lot of knowledge and be able to learn the fundamentals, and that's what I've been taught in school, you know. To be able to learn the fundamentals before even trying to use a framework. Because using a framework is easy. But when you want to go back to the fundamentals of solving the smallest problem, finding the smallest bug, you got to know the fundamentals. And that's what I felt that building it like that would help me in the long run. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead.
So how do you earn from it? Like your website?
Okay, so Tripliner is an itinerary planning platform and it's free for travelers to use. You can go in, you can plan your itinerary, and we do have activities as well as hotels in Tripliner, which you can actually purchase. You can book your hotel through our platform. Not through our platform, but we focus mainly on itinerary planning. So we try to incorporate every touch point of a traveler. You know, hotels is definitely something you need if you want to go for a holiday. So that's why we came up with hotel bucket listing. We will bucket list these hotels, and we actually tie up with Hotels Combined to actually help you, compare prices. So having that touch point is very important for travelers. So every time you make a booking or you actually click through, you know, we do monetize from that as well. We tie up with credible partners for activities such as Vita. To provide activities, unique activities to travelers so that they can add it to their trip and at the same time purchase attraction tickets. What I realized as a traveler is when you want to go overseas, let's say for example, I want to go to Rome and I'll go to Colosseum, right? I don't know who to purchase my attraction tickets from. I can go there and purchase, that's for sure. But if I want to pre-purchase it, where do I purchase it from? Do I purchase it from Viator? Do I purchase it from the website itself, which is in Italian, which I don't know how to read, or use Google Translate or something. So what we have done is break down the animosity between the traveler and who they are buying the attraction tickets from, right? So you don't want to be putting your credit card, you know, details into just any website. You could just get scammed, you know. So what we have done is break down the animosity, be able to provide you with credible partners to be able to book these tickets, you know, from, not through us, but from these credible partners that we have chosen. Yeah, so that's our revenue model, as well as we do some B2B, which is still in the works, and we are still talking to some of our partners to actually push out our underlying technology to them, which is the itinerary planning. Yeah.
Great. Which is more difficult, talking to hotels, arranging with them, or just developing the applications?
I don't talk to hotels directly. So I talked to
events arrangements.
I think both have its own challenges. Developing, because I'm an engineer, you know, my background is engineering, so developing is pretty much in my blood, you know. I pick up pretty fast, you know, I learn as I go along. But talking to hotels is one thing. Hotels tend to be very narrow-minded. The only thing that the hotels want is to sell their rooms. That's all. They don't want anything else. They just want to make sure that my rooms are filled every single night, 100% occupancy rate. Right. So hotels tend to be quite narrow-minded in terms of being how they want to approach selling their rooms. A lot of people just go OTA and, you know, I'm just going to list it on OTA, let them take a cut, and you know, I'm just going to hands off. If you ask a lot of hotels, they actually don't spend anything on digital marketing, like $0, literally. And those hotels are pretty high up, you know, on TripAdvisor, and they spend $0 on marketing. So it's pretty impressive. And that's why they have so much trust in these OTAs, like hotels.com, bookies.com, whatnot, because they bring them revenue. You know, they sell their rooms for them. So yeah, I would say that both has its own challenges. But if you were to ask me, of course, speaking to, you know, hotels or our partners would be definitely a bigger challenge there. Yeah.
Package manager like Composer?
Yes, we do. I do use Composer for the backend. Actually, for when we use Solar, Apache Solar, there is a package called Solarium that actually helps interface with Solar itself. So it's much simpler to use that package. The package manager, you know, it auto updates itself, the module, and be able to connect to Solar. And Solar is actually a very low level configuration for indexing, so it's like a flat file, and it's actually very fast, although it's very memory intensive because it runs on Java. So in that case, yeah, managing your packages using Composer is definitely, it's like npm, same thing. Yeah, so I think with that you can actually see the high level versions that you're using, so that, you know, if there's any dependency or what's not. So, and best part is just, you know, command line, just click and install. So it's very simple to do. So yeah, I definitely, Composer is something that you should use if you want to manage your dependencies. Yeah. I haven't experienced any of that yet. In terms of dependencies, not so much. I don't use a lot out there because our platform itself is quite customized. In terms of the usability of it, the whole functionality of everything, it's very customized. There's not a lot of modules or frameworks out there that we can tap on to be able to quickly push out a particular product. So a lot of things is built in-house. Yep. Pretty much didn't really face any dependency or any, you know, issues like regarding that.
One of the arguments against writing your own framework is it makes it harder to hire people. So when you hire someone, looking for someone who work for you, they have to ramp up and learn your framework before they get productive.
Yes, I think mean will be a good gauge of that. So yes, it is a bit difficult, but if you look at it, it's still an MVC framework, right? You have your model, your view, your controller. It's pretty standard. I think just like a couple of days of really explaining and being able to, I believe in sitting next to my employee or what's not, to be able to coach, you know, bring him or her up to speed, you know, in terms of the whole framework, and being able to utilize that. It's something we cannot move away from. Really, we are too deep down the rabbit hole to do any changes. For us, in terms of that, PHP was a very good choice. You know, like the socket IO. You know, when we are going to do, more socket applications. You know, real time exchange.
How long have you been working on this?
We've been working on it for about 1.5 years. And half year while I was still working in HP. Yeah, so it takes a lot of time and dedication. I'm not like your rock star programmer. So I learned everything from scratch, and I'm a person who prefer to do it myself kind of person. So along the whole journey I've learned a lot. When it comes to programming, or actually, you know, talking to businesses, talking to other startups, you know, collaboration and what's not. It's a very vibrant community, and yeah, it's something to be. It's very interesting, you know. It's very different from your normal 9-to-5 job kind of thing. Yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
My question is going to be about.
Okay, so we don't do any payments on our platform. we are mainly focused on itinerary planning, social itinerary planning. So you can actually invite your friends to plan with you. You can plan your itinerary. You can actually copy someone else's itinerary if you're too lazy to plan. But whatever booking, it's done off our site. So for example, if you find this hotel that you want to stay in, it's usually on hotels.com or booking.com. If it's this activity, it's on Viator or City Discovery or our partner's website. We don't do any booking on our platform. So, but it, in terms of payment gateways, there's quite a few up there, like PayPal, WorldPay, and what's not. They are quite easy to implement. Takes a couple of hours. You know, documentation is quite very good. Yeah, so it's not hard to implement. Yeah, if you have to. Yeah.
Yeah. So my question is a bit more related to your startups.
Yeah.
So you said you were still working with HP for a couple of months before you,
yes,
you quit and went full time. So when was the first part is when was the break point where you decided to quit and to just go all in on this product? Then the next question is like assuming you are like hopefully you are now profitable. So like when do you start expanding your team from like you plus your co-founder to a group of developers and
okay. You know, like, yeah, to answer your first question is when I realized I didn't have enough sleep. Yeah, because my job in HP was quite long hours. I just, when people work 9 to 5, I work from 9 to 5, then go back to the server room at 10 p.m. all the way at 6 a.m. because I had to do implementation, right? I only can do it when people are not there, right? So that was the turning point when I started this as a side project, you know, as a hobby. And so once I started it, then I told a couple of friends. And this is something that I learned. If you have an idea, don't be afraid to share it, because it's not like someone will copy it, but it's actually to validate your idea. I believe that if only you and only you, right, is able to go through with the whole idea, they can copy your idea, but they won't have the same passion and the same drive to actually execute it as you are to execute it. So yeah, I shared my idea with a couple of people, and I think about 3-4 months down. And you know, as engineers, you always get pissed off when people say, "Hey, is it done yet?" It's like, I want to hit you in the face, though. Like, it's not that simple to just spin up something. It's not that simple. So yeah, I mean, at that point in time, I was like, you know, since so many people are asking me of such a thing, you know, why not I take the leap of faith and actually quit my job to, you know, be able to, you know, work on it full time. But of course, you must calculate your finances plus your commitments and what's not to be able to jump and take that leap of faith, right? To answer your second question is, when is the right time to sort of build the team? I think you should build the team right from the start, right? If you have the capabilities to actually hire, you should, but hire wisely, as well as when you spend your money, try to be lean when you do that for a company. I've seen companies that get big funding and start spending like crazy, and 6 months down the road, they run dry, right? So in terms of that, I think you got to have a projection of how long you want to last and give yourself that deadline and that timeline to be able to bring the product up to speed. The first 6 months to 1 year will be a lot of iteration. If you were ask me my Tripliner as a product, what it was from day one, it's a total different product. We have not say pivoted, but we have moved in a different direction. Be able to come up with a different kind of UI and be able to accommodate with different kind of people. It's a total different product, right? So along the way, you learn and you'll be able to tap on ideas of other people as well. And feedback, that's something that's very important. You must always be open to feedback to be able to take that feedback and be able to improve the product as it goes along. Right. Like I said, iteration when it comes to a startup it should be very fast. You know, when you hear feedback, if you think that it's right, you know, you discuss with the team, and that's important. We'll be able to discuss and throw ideas around. If it's gonna be implemented, the timeline is usually 1 week, 2 weeks, kind of timeline. Yeah.
So So if for us, like if we don't have a co-founder or someone with capital to inject into the product, so like roughly how much or like how would you bootstrap your startup, you know, to survive the first few months?
Okay, my Tripliner is also bootstrap, right? In the beginning, it was not a lot of money that we put in. It doesn't take a lot to have an instance on AWS. You get 1 year free, right? If you sign up, and it's a T2 micro or something. T2 micro. Yeah, so it's working, and you can do a lot of stuff on it, right? Only when you maybe launch the product, okay, then you know, you upgrade your instance or what's not. So in terms of cost to start a startup, a technology startup, it's not a lot. Of course, it depends. If you're going to do like some e-commerce, you need to stock stuff, then I'm not experienced in that. Maybe you got to talk to someone who's more experienced in that. But or you need to buy like vehicles or something like that, then yes, startup cost is much higher. But if it's pure technology, I think you are the biggest asset. You know, whether you find a co-founder, that's up to you. If you think that you can do it, but what I feel that you should find is people whom you can communicate with, as well as you must make the team rounded, right? If you're good in programming, find someone who is good in maybe finance or business development or what's not, so that you can see both sides of the coin. You know, some people think in a more product perspective. Some people think in a more business perspective. So it's good to have both sides of the coin. If you focus too much on your product, it's not going to go anywhere, because unless you're going to make the next Facebook or something, then you can try, right? The next unicorn and what's not. But I think it's good to have a good rounded team. I think the team itself is very important. The culture you bring to the team is also very important. Yeah. Any more questions?
One question, you mentioned that you're using for scaling myself. Have you run into any issues? So you say that you just build up these instances, but have you looked further with regards to optimization, like
using
spam cache or something
along those lines? We do use spam cache. So the only time we spin up instances is when there is an overload. So we spin up the app instance, but we don't spin up like database or what's not. Currently, our database is still okay. The workload is still reasonable to be able to be handled, but to spin up instances, it's just really the app, right? Having a load balancer in front of it, that's all. And we do utilize a lot of CDNs. We use CloudFront to actually distribute our images, and we'll be implementing actually Akamine to distribute our JS files and CSS files and whatnot. So you don't bring too much load onto the server. Most of the load would come from API calls to the server itself, and we tend to try to optimize in terms of the SQL database. You must do correct indexing, you know, be able to relate tables together, you know, in a proper way. You know, your queries must be optimized and what's not, so as to not have long query times and everything like that. So we did meet a few problems when it comes to long queries, because we sometimes have a million over rows in our database and it's quite intensive. The first problem we met was text search. So we did not have Solr in the beginning. So we have 80,000 destinations in our database. And text search 80,000 with a wildcard in front and behind, it takes a while. It really takes a while. So what we did is implement, you can either implement Elasticsearch or Solr. Right, to actually to take that portion out of the database and actually run it as an instance itself. Yeah, so that's what we did. Yeah.
So when do you actually start doing this kind of optimization after a launch? Before you actually realize that, hey, the standard database stack probably out of the box doesn't work that well?
We didn't run into a lot of problems. Because we don't stream like videos, our images are handled by CloudFront. So in terms of that, we didn't really hit much very heavy loads. Like I said, the only biggest problem is long query calls because of the size of our database. So I would say you should have a plan for scaling, but that plan should come in. You should test out the plan but it should only take effect when, you know, you want to start implementing or what's not. And I haven't tried, but I think Chef.io is quite good to manage your servers. That's what I heard. So I'm going to touch on that pretty soon, you know, just to try it out. Like I said, before we even scale, you should, you know, try to test things out, see what's the best solution to that. Yeah, so this is it's something that we are looking into as well. Yeah. Any more questions?
No questions for me.
If not, please support. Yeah, so you can go to tripliner.com, sign up. We also have an Android app. You can download if you have an Android phone. Yeah, and sign up and support and plan your next holiday.
Thank you.
Yeah, all right. Thank you.